Thank you very much. Thank you as well, Yuri, for pronouncing my name perfectly. And thank you to the organizers for inviting me to this great meeting. It's a great honor to be here. Now, I want to say at the beginning that Noga was and is it was a great pleasure to know him and to talk to him and to exchange ideas and work with him. And he sort of is one of the fixtures of my certainly mathematical life. So happy to be here. Now, the advantage of this it's high technology of producing slides in the written form and then scanning it. And there are many advantages, it goes fast, but there are as well disadvantages, and one of them is that you cannot change it, or I cannot change it somehow online. So I cannot produce any pictures of Tel Aviv or the healthy pillow of which Lex found on the internet. But I have something different. I don't have a healthy pillow with the name of Noga, but I have a healthy pillow for Noga. So I give it to him, so that maybe he will be healthy thanks to this. And now I think at least one of the lectures at this meeting should be about Ramsey theory, which somehow is one of the very active and one of the principal fields, I think, of Noga activity. I mean, you can see it when I was thinking about the lectures. I was looking at his paper and at the international plenary lecture at the International Congress in Beijing in 2002, and which is called Discrete Mathematics, Methods, and Problems, and Challenges, I think, Methods and Challenges. And this is actually a very nice paper, I mean, and it's worth to read it even now, after almost 15 years. I mean, if only for the feeling how the field is really developing and what was achieved in it. And it's a, of course, this is a special opportunity. It was even for Noga a special opportunity to give a plenary lecture at the International Congress. And it's a sort of really panorama of his work and his activity. I like the paper very much, and I was lecturing about giving a synopsis of that paper several times. I couldn't include anything, but I included one picture, which is this is a famous building, you know, because Noga Aaron was lecturing in that building several times, you know, so it's a famous building. Maybe one of the days there will be plaque there, you know, that Beethoven was around the corner and Noga Aaron was in that building. So my lecture is about Ramsey theory. So just to fix an idea, let's begin in pedestrian way, recalling the Ramsey theorem for graphs. Here it is in different language for more colors and imitating already a little bit of notation, which will follow. I mean, of course, I mean this is the Ramsey theory, as we know from classical books, is a broad area, and I'm explaining one of the niche, which I think is interesting and rapidly developing recently. Actually, I cannot resist to say there is a very nice book about Ramsey which was recently published. It's a book by Margaret Paul, it's called Ramsey, And it's actually it's an autobiography, not autobiography, it's a biography of a Frank written by his sister. His sister lived and died very recently, or 10 years ago, and she brought posthumously was published memoirs about his brother, her brother, and it's a very, very, very nice book actually. So it's containing a lot of surprising details, which at least I didn't know. And he's a finite drums hitter, and he brought even countable version of it. I mean, it's a which is a theorem about, and I, this is actually related more to the topic of what I'm speaking about. And it was fortunate. I mean, the Ramsey theorem was fortunate in historically in manifold aspects. But one of the was that they were early on, very other theorems which were, regarded, which were popular or which were known, and here are some names. And in the 60s there were other theorems. It was in 60s and 70s came sort of, particular thanks to Paul Erdős, notoriously asking questions and good questions, where other theorems were found. And these are, in many respects, these are sort of difficult. Some of them are, or most of them are quite difficult, interesting results, which are sometimes difficult to prove, and sometimes there is only one proof. I mean, and they are not even too much known. For example, this MPC sets, which is Walter Dauber-Hara axiomatization of the Rado conjecture, which led to solution of Rado conjecture, deserves to be studied more, I believe. And they form there is a full Ramsey theorem for them, which was then by Lev. There is a finite vector space theorem. There is, of course, a parameter set, which is generalization of Hales-Jouvet, which was theorem, which was instrumental in the development. And there were problems about the graphs, which were asked by Paul Erdős and Heinel and others around that time. And this led in the beginning of 70s to the notion of Ramsey class. And that notion, I think, the combinatorist view, something like somehow easy extension of the Ramsey theorem. But I think there is more to it, and this is the subject of my talk. So let us define this Ramsey class. So it may sound on the first glance as unnecessary abstract definition, but in fact it is not. I mean, it is abstract definition, but I mean it's really tailored just in very easy way to that formulation of the last formulation of Ramsey theorem, which I stated before. So what is it again? So you have a class of structures. I mean, and that class of structures, you know what are the subobjects there. You know what typically they are. These subobjects are carried by some mappings, which you call embeddings. And if you have two objects there, then B choose A, B and A. Then B choose A denotes a set of all subobjects of the B, which are isomorphic to A. That notation, inspired obviously by Bernoulli coefficient, was actually originated in this area. I think it's due to Klaus Lev. And do we say that K has A Ramsey property if the theorem, which was before, and if that formulation of Ramsey theorem, the last one, which was given above, holds in the class with this interpretation? So with the denoting instead of all p element subsets of a set binomial coefficient. So you speak about the all subobjects which are isomorphic to A. So then this here it is explicitly written. So if you take any partition, as we know, Ramsey, Tori, if there was any structure on the C, you forget it. This is just a set partition. I mean, the enemy partition. So the enemy is partitioning all the subset, all the substructure of C which are isomorphic to A. Nevertheless, you can always find given structure. Given something which is isomorphic to given structure, so that all the A subobjects are in one class of the partition. So I mean, if this is easy to stay, and it's analogous to the statement, and you say that K is Ramsey class, is Ramsey, if it is A Ramsey for every its object. Yeah. So clearly this is a kind of top of the line of Ramsey properties. I mean, you could say that Ramsey class, that you can color anything, any given object, copies of any given object of this A, and in any finite number of colors, you obtain a given object which is monochromatic. This is a domain of the theory of finite sets. I mean, all the objects I'm thinking about the finite. There are a few examples which are, transfinite Ramsey theorem itself, which are holding for infinity. But I mean, essentially, this is a domain of the combinatorial principle. Saharon has a paper with Komiat, which is actually formalizing it already in very simple cases. I think for the K for free graphs, which are easy for triangle and continuum and colors, for example. Yeah. So I mean, this is such a classes are on the first glance are not too many. I mean, here are some examples. So I mean, so we find the Ramsey theorem itself in various interpretations. Finite vector spaces, parameter sets. There are theorems about the trees, you know, the Joule-Ramsey theorem. Right? It's not full list, but actually it's almost full list. There are not too many examples of Ramsey classes because as I will be discussing later on. Notably, I mean, it's not if you take all graphs, finite graphs, they are not Ramsey, and they, for example, as well, not the Poe sets are not Ramsey. So what is, if this slide would be the whole affirmation, then what basically to study, I mean, you would, and it was a generalizing feeling of the people in the area that these Ramsey classes, it's somehow maybe too much to ask that they are not too many. But it seems only on the first glance because you can do something. And, can we attempt to characterize Ramsey classes? If there are so many, maybe we can have a characterization, and that's important. And the new impetus for the study of these classes came approximately 10 years, or in last, say, 10, 15 years ago, and started here by proofs of Benji Weiss, Eric Grasner, and then it was sort of axiomatized developed in fully by people in topological dynamics and ergodic theory by Kechris, Pestov, and Todorcevic and other, and it's a quite active field. And actually, these people actually really ask what are the characterization of these Ramsey classes, or somehow try to extend the spectrum of these Ramsey classes as much as possible. And so we should, I think we should somehow, we are always doing it, but maybe we combinators should do it somehow more intensively, somehow to try to find out what actually these Ramsey classes can can express, or which Ramsey classes, so what is their characterization. And if you think it over, then there are two obstacles for Ramsey classes, which on the first glance look contradictory. Yeah, and this is that something is not a Ramsey class if it is not symmetric in a certain sense, and something is not a Ramsey class if it lacks rigidity. And I will explain these points. And symmetry, symmetry and rigidity. Symmetry is based on this result that if you have a hereditary Ramsey class, and which somehow has a, what's called the joint embedding property, which means somehow it's a directed, so that every two elements are contained in something, but there is something like this joint union, for example, or there is a bigger object which contains both of them, then it is so-called amalgamation class. This is slightly confusing for many people because the amalgamation is not what you think by amalgamation. I mean, so normally, amalgamation is just this diagram, the amalgamation of two things, or two objects, B1 and B2, with respect to object A, and these two embeddings, or these two maps, is any object for which there exist two mappings here, so that is the diagram computes. So for example, if you amalgam two triangles as a buff with respect to the edge, then for example triangle itself is amalgamation because you can embed it there so that these two embeddings coincide on that edge. As well this middle example is a amalgam, and that's what you usually would understand under amalgam. As well, K4 is an amalgam, K5 is as well amalgam. So it's not a uniquely determined. I mean, this if you have this normal, what one understands normally amalgam, that's called the free amalgamation, and the strong amalgamation is that you don't identify any extra vertices except of this common part. And this Ramsey classes is giving you only this weak amalgamation. You just know that, I mean, if you have two objects which have a common part, then there exists one of these amalgamations is possible there. I mean, a little bit more, you can say, but not much more. So you have so this is sort of necessary condition why it is called symmetry, or why symmetry. I mean, it's so amalgamation class is, this is a concept, this is one of the key concepts of the model theory. Amalgamation class is hereditary, joint embedding, and for every triple with these two maps, you have an amalgam in the previous sense. So the amalgamation class is that you have amalgamation and which is hereditary and is joint embedding. And why you call it symmetry? Because of the classical result as well belonging to model theory, which is called Frazer theorem, which is describing all the amalgamation classes. And all the amalgamation, that's very pretty, all the amalgamation classes are coming from supersymmetry. I mean, as an H, so class of all finite substructures of some what's called ultra-homogeneous structure. Homogeneous usually, topology means that it's homogeneous, it's like a transitive from points. I mean that way between any two points you have a homeomorphism, and here you mean not only between the points but between everything. So if you take any here is a sort of illustration of the concept. If you have a two finite substrate, so you say that U, this big one, is ultra homogeneous. If you take a two finite substructure, say an A prime, and you take some partial isomorphism, so you take isomorphism of A into A prime, they may intersect, may not contact, doesn't matter. So if you have an alpha as a isomorphism between A and A prime, then you can always extend it to the global isomorphism of the of the whole structure. So it's in combinatorial or in graph theory, this is studied in particular cases. I mean, so such a structure is point symmetric and line symmetric, or point transitive, line edge transitive, and so on. Everything transitive, right? So as a result of it, there are just a few such structures. I mean, for example, with a few exceptions, I mean, it's a complete graph from and to C5 and some what's called window graph. There are basically no finite examples. I mean, a complete bipartite graph, for example, but I mean, Turan graph. But there are only these complete or quasi-complete graphs, finite, which are isomorphic. But for infinite, there is a deep theorem of Lachman-Woodrow, which is characterizing them. And there are just a few examples like that, or few languages for which this is fully understood. So I mean, this Frazer theorem is saying that I mean that something is a monomation class if and only if it is a H of this supersymmetric structure. So we know in this sense that I mean this is characterization of this Ramsey class is reduced to the characterization. If we would know that what are these ultra homogeneous structures, then we would know, I mean we could then look at the list and check which of those is Ramsey or which of them is not Ramsey. But I mean this is I mean, complicated thing because I mean this is well known problem, the characterization program even of the trying to characterize all ultra homogeneous structure in a given language. But still I mean we could proceed, I mean something like in this way. So we could proceed that having a Ramsey class, we know that it's amalgamation that is leading to some ultra-homogeneous, and then we could ask for whether we couldn't change it a little bit to add some relations, do some what's called modulatory expansion, we call it lifts, usually in combinatorial setting, because we can lift the structure in such a way so that we get a Ramsey class, and this is became known as Ramsey classification program. Yes?
Lift mean, for example, like taking graph and replacing them by order graph?
Yes. I will give an example in a second. Yeah. So this is somehow explaining this symmetry part. Actually, this lift is actually related to the to the lack of rigidity, to this other aspect, I mean, as well. So if you have finite graphs, then they fail to be Ramsey class. And why they fail to be? I mean, so for example, because by an easy, here is a sort of one of the first instances why it fails. I mean, for every in the language which we had before for this arrowing, CC does not arrow pentagon for partitioning the passes of length 2. I mean, something is a Ramsey class, and that's the sense that you can partition everything, so every nonsense, so to say, so you can partition as well passes of length 2. Of course, I mean, there is a graph which is arrowing it for edges, for example, but for this, it is not true. Why it is not true? Because you have these three types of ordered passes of length 3. So I mean, you have distinguished the isomorphic copy of the pass of length 2, whether the in some ordering, whether there is a minimal vertex, whether it is a maximal vertex, whether it is monotone triple. So yeah, I mean, you take arbitrary C, you order it arbitrarily, you partition the passes of length through in these three classes. In fact, two are enough, and you just observe that in every pentagon you have to have both. In fact, you have to have all three of these instances in a given ordering, arbitrary ordering of C. So it cannot be Ramsey. But I mean, but if you add the editor's ordering, if you make the slave expansion, if you make the slave to your editor ordering, and you consider the monotone embedding, then it became Ramsey, and that we proved a long time ago with Wojta. So I mean, this is just explaining the monotone embedding. I mean, this zigzag doesn't go there, right? So as a monotone way, it goes there. It goes as monotonely, but it doesn't go in this way. So you can distinguish them. So I mean that in another word, too, because it's Ramsey, you can iterate it. So I mean that somehow this color of your path of length 3 will depend on the order type which this path gets in some ordering. Somehow this one of the strongest result in this is that if you take arbitrary finite relation structures, then they're all linearly ordered. They all linearly ordered finite structures in their language are forming Ramsey class, and that's really useful. It's a prototype of the theorem, which is used, and basically it's like a first building block in the further generalizations. So this structure plus additional information that's called, depending from which community you are coming, I mean, we call it lift. I mean, the model theory, it's traditionally called expansion of the structure. And most frequent lift or most frequent expansion is provided by linear ordering, not exclusively. Sometimes you have to add color edges, and sometimes you have to add many relations, and that is leading to the study that was studied for in its own sake quite intensively. It's called ordering property, from a probabilistic point of view, it was studied recently, and it was started by Angelke, Chris and Lyons in another context of the topological dynamics, and then other people. I mean, here is missing Ballister, Golobash, and Janssen have a nice paper about it, recent paper, I don't know. But this is sort of side. I want to speak about somehow more general context. So the lift need not be only ordering. Now, if you think it over, so I'm just asking whether this you have this ultra-homogeneous structure and you would like to take some lift so that it became Ramsey. Now this is easy question, right? So I mean, you can, for example, you can take a lift which you color every point differently, and then it became Ramsey because they will have only one copy of every subobject. So you have to restrict, and natural restriction is locally finite or pre-compact lift. And so it means you want, if you have a one point, so one point should use only finitely many colors. I mean, if you have a one edge, it should use only finitely many colors. So for every arity, you should have only finitely many relations. Particularly, maybe you could have finitely many new relations at all, and so in that case you would speak about the finite lift. And then it makes sense, and in fact it seems almost and for some time some people conjecture that every ultra-homogeneous structure may be changed to Ramsey by lifting it by finitely many symbol by a finite language, and this is in fact true in many instances. I mean, if you go through the through the list of the ultra homogeneous structure, for example, through the list of ultra homogeneous graphs, characterized by Lachlan Woodrow. I mean, then you observe that actually all of this ultra homogeneous structure became Ramsey. I mean, which either it's easy to see, or it's some kind of version of Ramsey theorem, or this is a known result, like this result about forbidding complete graphs. And the same is true for directed graphs, where the list is quite extensive already. There continue many examples of it, but they are of the of the countably many types. I mean, for the Bachelor orders, well, there are not too many, four types of ultra homogeneous structures. I mean, and so for them, this was recently characterized for tournaments. I mean, so the problem is that in these cases, where the classification of this ultra homogeneous is known, they were approved by various people, but mostly by Chatelain. In these cases where the ultra homogeneous are characterized, we know actually that the question whether they can be changed to Ramsey classes holds. And it's a little sentiment in it that basically there are no new Ramsey theorems in it. I mean, it's basically confirming that for us combinatorists is pleasing, because basically it claims that we knew all of them. We knew all Ramsey classes before. The other are simply some change, or can be derived from some key statement. But nevertheless, I mean, every ultra homogeneous structure or every H of leads to H, which can be changed by adding finitely many, in all these cases, by finitely many relations, so that the class became Ramsey.
And meaning for every finite thing
there are. For every finite as well, yeah. If you have a finite ultra homogeneous, then you can do it that you color every point differently, for example. That's a finite. Well, that's a different thing. If you would fix the number of colors before that, that's a little different question. Right?
And you are asking about the result is an infinite set or an infinite structure, or which is ultra homogeneous, or any arbitrary finite?
No, infinite, including the countable. Finite too. So that's but So I mean, this question or this takes the following form, that you have some structure which is a technical term, omega categorical, which means that there are finitely many types of points, finitely many types of edges, finitely many, so the automorphism group has finitely many orbits on every for every arity. So if you have omega categorical structure, is it a, it may seem on the first glance that it is a H of finite local, so that if you take the H of it, then you will get something, you will get class of finite structures which have a Ramsey, which have a finite or locally finite lift. And actually this is not true. It was a recent result by David Evans, who found the examples, and I think this is a tip of iceberg.
The difference with the previous theorem, that there is a finite expansion. Even you written earlier that there is one in the previous theorem.
Yes.
It's a theorem A, of only graphs.
Only graphs, undirected. This is, yes, maybe I should say it more explicitly. I mean, these are undirected graphs, these are directed graphs. In this area, there is actually a huge difference between oriented and undirected graphs, and directed graphs are much easier, so they were characterized much earlier than, for example, this ultra homogeneous directed graph. But I mean, this is very just for those classes. But now, if you would ask that generally, every omega categorical, if you have a structure which is omega categorical, you take a finite h of it, whether this has a Ramsey lift, the answer is negative, I mean. And that was proved by David Evans, which is analyzing Hrushovsky construction of omega categorical, very sparse graphs, graphs which have orientation where the our degree is two, at most two for every vertex. And it is non-trivial. I mean, non-trivial on this Hrushovsky part. It is, well, it's very nice observation. I think it's actually tip of the iceberg. I mean, there will be more examples. This was found few weeks ago, and we work with Kubička on this and with Evans analyzing it or pushing it further. Yeah. But so I mean, if I don't think this is then in view of it, it's really not clear what are the further obstacles. I've listed two obstacles. I listed the rigidity, I listed the symmetry. Is there other obstacle? This is the third one, I mean, which is not yet well understood what is it. And I think basically that we shall have no characterization of Ramsey classes, probably because there will be as well this classification program for ultrahomogeneous as well, nowhere in sight that it would end with some explicit characterization. But what are the positive solutions? What are the evidence on the other side? Well, can we expand more? Can we find more examples of Ramsey classes? And we can, yeah. And that I will say in the rest of the talk. So you can first, I mean, I will list a few increasingly stronger and stronger results. So we can forbid irreducible structures. I mean, something is irreducible if it is complete graph. So you speak about, for example, hypergraphs or triple system. You say that the triple system is irreducible if every pair is covered by some triple. So irreducible in the sense amalgam irreducible, or strong free amalgam irreducible. That is the word. And you take if you forbid irreducible structures, then it became Ramsey is just by fixing some orderings, arbitrary free ordering, free orderings. I mean, this is exactly the moment when one should say this is where this Ramsey class is not easy generalization, say of the H Ramsey property or the Ramsey property with respect to partition something class. For example, because you can partition everything. So I mean, you forbid a triangle. Yeah. You take a class of graphs which don't contain triangle, and you are partitioning cycle of 100. So you partition a huge thing. I mean, and this huge thing, I mean, has to all these cycles have to overlap in many ways, but they cannot create a triangle anywhere. It's difficult to control because what you are forbidding is much smaller than you have to be able to partition everything. So any subset, no matter how big is it, is possible possible to partition in such a way that it guarantees a monochromatic solution. And so another extension which is more is they said you may forbid a homomorphism from finite set of connected subgraphs. You take that's a non-trivial theorem which somehow needs a lot of sort of preparation and which is covering many things. I mean, for example, it is covering. Covering partial, which we proved this before. It's even in many cases it's covering the metric spaces, which I say in the second. And it's related to just if you take a finite set of objects. For example, take a odd cycle length line. Yeah. So what does it mean that you are forbidding cocycle as a homomorphism? Well, you are forbidding cocycle, and then you are forbidding all the homomorphic images. You are forbidding triangle, you are forbidding pentagon, you are putting seven. And you claim that this is in some, there is some Ramsey lift for it. But particularly if it is Ramsey lift, so it's amalgamation, so there exists ultra homogeneous for it. So it means that there exists universal objects. There is a countable object which contains every countable subgraph which doesn't contain homomorphism from C9. And even that question is complicated. And that was settled in a nice paper. It's a particular example of a theorem which was proved by Chelin Shellach. And she about 15 years ago. And this is not a trivial theorem which was obtained by model theoretic means. And we have to understand it more. We have to put a hand on it. We have to provide an explicit description of these classes and somehow forbidding it. I will illustrate it in the next slide in a few minutes. So, and you can extend it. You can even forbid something what you say from infinite list of forbidden graphs. I mean, there is some sort of automata theory description of this. It has to come from some regular family of like regular languages, and you can get a Ramsey lift. Here is an example. It's a similar example. I said, think forbid the pentagon. I mean, I like the pentagon as an example. So take a class of all graphs which don't have a homomorphism from pentagon. Homomorphism is an edge-preserving mapping which is every vertex goes to some vertex, and edges are going to edges. And those which are not joined, maybe identified. So what is this class? This is a class of graphs which don't contain pentagon. And as well, some homomorphic image, which is a triangle. So triangle and pentagon, yeah. And so pieces which were in before will be tools. So I will create a lift of it. I mean, by creating two new relations, there will be relation 2 and relation 3, a name of the relation. And relation 2 means that there are two points, there exists a path of length 2 between them, and they are not joined. And relation 3 is that there exists a path of length 3 between these two vertices and these two pieces, I mean, are determining the class of this class of graphs. You can if you take this, you add to your graph relation these two new relations, then you can consider a graph which doesn't contain 2, 3 and 1, I mean 2, 2 and 1, and an edge here. And you can show that this, why this is not a Ramsey class. Why it is not a Ramsey class? Yeah. Because it has a point Ramsey property, it has edge Ramsey property, it has any complete graph property, because there are no others. But it doesn't have a two independent points property, a Ramsey property. Why? Because there are two kinds of the two independents. This is one, the two independent points, maybe a distance 2 or a distance 3 in the graph. And you can use it, you can partition it, and they can never be identified, because otherwise there would be created triangle. And you show that if you forbid those, if you consider relation structures which is containing edges and then two additional relations, 2 and 3, and you take the ordering of it, and you forbid those examples, then you can get a Ramsey, and you consider those which are complete. I mean that you have relation everywhere. Then you get a Ramsey lift of this class. And this is how it works in this finite forbidden graphs, this is how it works. It is above every example. Let me take another example. Yeah. Finite metric spaces, that was of some. This is interesting class. If you take a finite metric spaces, you can amalgam them, then this time not freely, but strongly only, because you have to complement metrics as well on those points which are not good together. And so if you take a finite metric spaces, they form amalgamation class, and the corresponding infinite graphs, if you complete it, it's called a Urizon space. In fact, this is good to say. I mean, Urizon, that was the last paper of Urizon, or one of the last paper of Urizon. And he anticipated this whole theory of the Frisei, which came in 50s, already then in a complicated example of this metric spaces. And my teacher in Prague was Kachetov, and last paper of Kachetov was actually on the Urizon space. I mean, so maybe one shouldn't work on Urizon space, because it may have some dangerous connotations. So that's so for finite metric spaces, I mean the model theory people are asking if this automorphism group of the Urizon space is extremely amenable, which by the Kirchner-Spest of Todorcevic theory, it's equivalent that finite metric spaces form a Ramsey class, and that was confirmed, that was proved about 10 years ago. I mean, this is not all. There are other examples of it. For example, Wojtav is a student, proved that the graphs with isometric embeddings, so metric spaces coming from graphs, I mean, are forming Ramsey class with a linear order. I mean, we recently proved this. Hubička, I'm working on it with my former student Hubička, who's a postdoc with Sauer in Calgary for a year now. That he actually inspired this theorem. If you take a S-metric space, so S-metric space is a metric space which is using values only from S. S is some set of real numbers, I mean, maybe infinity as well. And Norbert Sauer characterized for which sets there exist S Urizon space, and for all of them you can actually prove that they form a Ramsey class. So something is Ramsey class if and only if there exists this universal S Urizon space. And that's maybe one of the strongest. I think I should end in a second, right? I mean, so here is some master theorem on which, and well, let me say a few words. You see, I mean, it's sort of slowly closing the gap. I mean, so we know that the amalgamation is enough for, is necessary for Ramsey class. If it is strong amalgamation, we know that it is Ramsey. And that's, I mean, many of these results, particularly that one, it's not a Ramsey class, it means there exists a lift, which is Ramsey class. And it's explaining, and something about closures. And here is some key example where this recent development is coming from some strange example which for a graph theorists look really funny, but which has many, it's a key example in various questions model theory, in so-called bowtie free graph, where it's difficult to find a universal structure. We proved just a few years ago that this is a Ramsey class, and it's really complicated. It contains some 2 to the 6 additional relations which are added to it and leading to some. So there is a surprising variety of universality of the Ramsey classes, or maybe it is our intuition which we had in the beginning, that there are just a few, or I mean, they are necessarily few, because they was difficult to establish them. Maybe it's not as true. If you praise it, that you can change the structure a little bit by adding colors, And I think this finite left, this is surprising variety. Okay, so, that I should say. We shall next fall. This is commercial break, as initiated by John. So we shall have a docus. That may be my last docu. We started doing docus with Vizir Kamatušek, as several from you know, from some 10 years ago. And so it's a semester program. We shall have some support for students, and I think several people in the hall will come to give a lecture or short course there. And so if you, if one of your students, or if you are interested, please write me. Well, all the best wishes, Noga.